Well, it might be hard to believe, but we are on week 13 of our series. Some of you are like, it may not be hard. It's not hard, man. This thing's lasted forever. But the reality is we're in week 13 in our series entitled Authentic Transformation in Me, where we have been looking at the process through which God wants to change and transform our lives. We've been saying all along that living a victorious Christian life is not a DIY project. It is God who wants to do the work of transformation in our lives. And we've been looking at that process. But here, I want to start with this question this morning. How many of us are willing to admit that there are times where we get a little weary of trying to live the life God's created us to live? We get a little weary, don't we? But here's the thing I want you to understand. God doesn't want you to be weary and exhausted. God wants you to enter into His rest. You say, well, what are you talking about, Brian? Well, if you got your Bible this morning, I want to encourage you to turn to Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3, and while you're finding your place, let me just kind of set the stage, because the book of Hebrews, we're not sure who wrote that, but actually is written to a group of Jewish Christians who were undergoing persecution, who were undergoing some discouragement, and the letter was written to challenge and encourage them to not only to keep the faith, but also to go on to spiritual maturity in their lives. And so here in chapter 3, the writer is talking about their Jewish forefathers and encouraging them not to make the same mistake that their fathers had made. How many are like, I understand that precept, right? I don't want to make the same mistake somebody who went before me made, right? We want to learn from our mistakes. I want you to understand that in the United States, we're not real good at that. Because if we don't, I'm going to figure it out on my own. I want to make my own mistakes. And yet, Scripture is filled with all kinds of exhortation and encouragement of, hey, this happened, don't do this again, right? This is a really bad plan. Let's not go there again. So Hebrews chapter 3, verse 7 says, therefore, just as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you hear His voice. Now, hear His voice. We're talking about you sensing the voice of Holy Spirit directing and leading your life, okay? I hear His voice. I feel His pull. I feel His tug, okay? That's what we're talking about. Today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your heart as when they provoked me in the day, as on the day in which the trial in the wilderness, where your fathers put me to the test and I saw my work and saw my works for 40 years. Verse 10, therefore I was angry with this generation and said, they always go astray in their heart and they did not know my ways. So I swore in my anger that certainly they shall not enter into my rest. Now, what's he talking about here? Well, he's talking about the Israelites. Now, you got to remember the story, right? They're for 400 years, 10 generations, they had been in Egypt in slavery. It was no picnic at the park for the Israelites. They were enslaved, making bricks every single day. And they were enduring the chains of unrest and the chains of slavery. And in the midst of all that, they began to cry out to God, God, God. Come rescue us. Come save us. Come bring us out of this and into the promises that you had. And you remember what God did? God raised up a guy by the name of Moses. Amen. We know Moses. And what did Moses do? He said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go back to Egypt. I want you to tell Pharaoh, let my people go. If through the hand of Moses, God brought 10 plagues on Egypt. And eventually what happened? The Egyptians said, get out of here. Get on up out of here, take all our valuables, get out of here, and they leave and part the Red Sea, through the Red Sea. You know, we know the story. And they suddenly were no longer bound by the bonds of slavery. They were now free. But you know what? They were still homeless. Come on, let's put that in context. Now we're out in the wilderness. We've got a few days' food, but now we're out. We got no place to live, no place to call home. And in fact, I want you to understand that for centuries, even before Egypt, God's people had never had a home. They were all nomads. They just wandered from place to place to place, set up their tent, fed their sheep, took care of their family. They were nomads. But now God said, here's what I want. I want you to enter into my rest. Because for centuries, He had been promising, I will give you a place where you can rest. Say, well, what's this rest you're talking about? Well, since the days of Abraham, what was the promise? I'm going to give you the land of Canaan. I'm going to give you the promised land. And it wasn't just the fact that the land flowed with milk and honey. What was going to happen there? No longer will you have to wander. No longer will you be nomads, but I will give you a home, a place where you can rest, a place where you can raise your families. And you remember what the promise was. I'm going to give you a land, and I'm just not giving you land. I'm going to give you the city. I'm going to give you all the houses. I'm going to give you their wells. I'm going to give you their vineyards. It's going to be like a, getting one of those vacation houses, right? You just show up, and all the stuff's there. Isn't that great? You ever do that? You guys do that, right? Or the Vibro, I don't know. Whatever it's called, but what you do? You say, hey, we're going to come by. And what happens? You open the front door, and man, everything you need's in there. That's God's promise. I'm giving you the promised land. I want you to have this, and you're going to enter into my rest. So they come to Mount Sinai. They get the law. They come to the River Jordan, just outside of the promised land, and Moses sends in some spies. He sends in a reconnaissance team, and they go on in, and they're supposed to check out the land. And so they go in and they check it all out, and they come back. And what happened? Man, they start telling about all these incredible things that are there. Man, the grapes are as big as your head, and the land is fertile and it's great, and it truly does flow with milk and honey. And man, it's just incredible. But then they also start to talk about, but their cities are big and fortified, and they got great armies, and they're well organized, and they got some giants over there that make us look like grasshoppers, and we don't think it's possible for us to go in there. Joshua and Caleb are like, no, stop. We need to go in. We need to go in. We need to do this. But in spite of them warning the people that we need to trust God and just go ahead and take the land, the people are like, no. We can't go in. And Scripture says what? That God's anger burned against the people. And he declared what? That generation, anyone who was 20 years or older when they left Egypt, would never step into the promised land, would never take possession of the promised land, would never enter his rest. I tell you what, we look at that and we're like, wow, what in the world? How could they be so stupid? Come on, literally. I mean, here they are knocking on the door. God's already let them out. God took them through the sea, already done all the miracles, already fed them manna, already done all these incredible things. And they get there and they're like, I don't think he can. I don't think it's possible. It was all right there in front of them. It was all there what they wanted. You know, and have you ever been like that? You're like, you see something coming and you're screaming. You ever been watching a movie? You watch movies and sometimes you can tell what's going to happen by the movie. And you're like, no. In your spirit, you're like, no, don't go there. You know what's going to happen, and don't go down in the basement with all the chainsaws. Don't go do this. Don't get in that car. And you look at that and inside you're like, no. Maybe some of you aren't inside. You're actually yelling at the screen. Don't do it. That's what I feel like when we read Numbers 13 and 14, when we look at the Israelites. Like, no, don't do it. No, obey God. Take the promise. But no matter how hard I yell at my Bible, they never do it. They never do. Why? Why didn't they enter in? Why didn't they claim the promises of God? Why didn't they grab the life God wanted them to have? It was right there. Now, come on, let me put it in context. There's a great big giant double scoop ice cream cone right in front of you. And they say to you, you can have it. It's like, it's a no-brainer, right? I'm having me some ice cream. That's how it was with God. He's like, set it up right there for them. All they have to do is take it. He's going to do all the work. Why didn't they do it? Look at verse 12 in Hebrews 3. It says, take care, brothers and sisters, that there will not be in any one of you an evil, unbelieving heart that falls away from the living God. You say, well, what's he talking about? Well, first thing I want you to notice is he's writing to believers. You got to understand, this is not a message about salvation. We put way too many things in the salvation category. He's writing to believers. It's not about salvation. It's about receiving and taking hold of the fullness of God's promises for our lives. That's what he's talking about. It's about believing God. Verse 13, but encourage one another every day. Say, encourage everyone. Come on, we got to encourage one another. Amen. As long as it is still called today, so that none of you will be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin, for we have become partakers of Christ if we keep the beginning of our commitment firm until the end. Verse 15, while it is said, today, if you hear your voice, do not harden your hearts as when they provoked me. For who provoked him when they had heard? Now, here's the thing. They knew. They knew the promise. Amen? It's not like that, well, I'm not really clear about the promise here. No, they absolutely, totally knew the promise that God had for them. Do not, when they had heard, indeed, did not all of these who came out of Egypt led by Moses? They all knew. Verse 17, and with whom was he angry for 40 years? Was it with those who sinned, whose dead bodies fell in the wilderness? Verse 18, and to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but those who were disobedient? So we see that they were not able to enter because of unbelief. Why didn't they receive the promise of God? They didn't believe. They didn't believe. It was a lack of faith, a lack of trust. Their disobedience resulted in them not entering his rest. Now, there's an interesting thing there as we look at those verses, and it's this, that disobedience equals sin. And I'm going to say that again, disobedience equals sin. Now, see, when most of us think about sin, what are we thinking about? We're thinking about the list of do not do this, right? We're thinking about all the things that God says you shouldn't do. You know, you shouldn't do this, and you shouldn't do that. But disobedience is not doing what God has asked. Disobedience is not doing what God is leading me to do. Disobedience is not believing him for what he says. And I want you to understand, we have to understand that our disobedience equals sin. You see, if Paul is cheating on his wife, or if Sally is is gossiping all the time, or Bill has this, you know, issue with addiction, man, we look at that and we say, that's sin. Sin right there, right? We have no problem pointing that out. Even in our own lives, we have no problem pointing out the things that we are doing that we know we shouldn't be doing, right? We have no problem calling those out as sin. But what happens if I choose not to do what God asked me to do? What happens if I choose to ignore what God wants? What happens if I decide I want to do something else? You know, I know, God, you would like me to go this direction, but I'm going to go over here. Not that this is bad. I'm not talking about, you know, bad stuff. I'm talking about God says, I want you to go over here. And you're like, nah, I really like to go over here. I want you to understand that those things are disobedience. And according to this passage, disobedience is sin. Now, having made that point, he goes on in chapter 4 and says, now, in light of what happened to them, amen? Chapter 4, verse 1, therefore, we must fear if, while a promise remains of entering his rest, that any one of you may seem to have come short of it. Now watch this now. He says, before you get all judgmental about the Israelites, before you all put them in the bad decision hall of fame, he said, before you go doing that, you need to understand something. The promise of entering God's rest still remains. The promise of entering his rest. You know, we can get all shook up about what Israel did, but it's no different than what's happening in our lives because, see, God has put before us the promise of the fullness of life he's created us for, and he said, I want you to enter in. And when you enter into that, it will bring my rest. It's standing right before us. See, you got to understand, our journey is not that much different than Israel. Let me show you what I'm talking about. The Israelites were held captive in slavery by Egypt. You and I were held captive by what? Sin. You know, God sends Moses to set the people free. What happened? God sent Jesus to set us free from the chains of sin. Moses led the people out through the Red Sea. Jesus led us out of sin through what? The waters of baptism. Moses led people to Mount Sinai where they got the instruction on how God wanted them to live. Jesus, through Holy Spirit, instructs us on concerning how we are to live. Moses led people to the border of the promised land. Jesus leads us to the border of the promised life that he has declared for us. God called the Israelite to take possession of the land. And God is calling you and I to take possession of the fullness of life that he has for us. And God desired to give the Israelites rest from their wanderings and their uneasiness and their labors. And God desires to give us rest from our attempts and our struggles and our efforts to be who he's created us to be. I want you to understand, our journey is not any different than their journey. They had Moses. We have Jesus. They were on that side of the cross. We're on this side of the cross. But the reality is that that promise of rest still exists. He says, I want you to have the fullness of life. John 10:10, Jesus says this, you know, the thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But I have come that you might have life. Now let me help you. That's salvation. Jesus said, I've come that you might have life, that you might be saved, that you might be restored, comma, and have it more abundantly. See, I want you to understand that he said, I come that you might be saved, but I also want you to have the abundance, the fullness of life. I want you to enter into the fullness of my rest, not someday in heaven, not someday in eternity, but right here, right now, in 2022. I want you to enter into our rest. You say, well, how's that happen? When I begin to discover it's not I, but it's Christ who lives in me. When we begin to discover the fullness of Christ right now. But notice what he says here. It's got to be a priority focus for our lives. For he says, verse 1 again, it says, therefore, we must fear. Now, we don't like talking about fear, but the reality is that word there, it means to put to flight, to flee, to be terrified. I don't know. Let's pick on someone. Pat, if you're afraid, if you're really afraid, what's the tendency you want to do? You want to run, right? We're going to run away, right? We're going to get out of there. We don't want, hey, if the axe murderer's coming after us, what are we doing? We want to run, right? So what happens is that when we have, it's talking about that desire to flee, and that God's saying, you and I ought to have a healthy fear of missing out on the fullness of what God wants for our lives. Now, most of us know that kind of fear. You ever said something like this? You know, I'm afraid I'm going to miss the April 15th deadline. Or I am afraid to wait any longer to refinance. Or I'm afraid because of COVID my kids are going to get left behind. What are we saying? We have this fear that we're going to miss out on something really good, and that fear what? Thing. And that's the picture that's being painted here. God doesn't want you and I to miss out. And in fact, we ought to be aware of the fact that, you know what? I don't want to miss out. I don't want to miss out on the fullness of what he has for me. See, we're not talking about heaven. We're talking about now. You say, well, I'm going to get the fullness then. Absolutely you are. But listen, he wants you to walk in his rest and his fullness now. You say, well, why did they miss the promise? Verse 2. For indeed we have good news preached to us. Amen. How many of you are like, hey, we've gotten the message, all right? Just as they also did, but the word they heard did not benefit them. Oh, man. You ever had a word that didn't benefit you? What happened? Well, it tells you right here, because they were not united with those who listened with faith. Amen? What's he saying? He said, hey, those 10 other guys, they didn't have faith to believe God for the promise. And they listened to him. Who are we listening to? Who are we listening to? What's God want to do in us? They did not believe. You say, well, what's this rest look like? Look at verse 3. But who has believed, but we who have believed enter that rest, just as he has said, as I swore in my anger, they certainly shall not enter my rest. Although his works were finished from the foundation of the world. Now, that word rest, there's an interesting word. You know, you think, well, Brenda will say, I need to rest. I need to put up, after work, what do you, I need to put my feet up and rest. Anybody ever identify with that? Come on, amen, right? That's a good, but that's not the kind of rest it's talking about here, okay? The rest it's talking about here is to put to rest. It means to cease from work, a resting rest. Let me see if I can give you an illustration of that. So let's say that when you were raising your kids, anybody remember those days? Come on, Dana's smiling. You remember those days? And the kids went to grandma's. Now we're smiling. Woo! Kids all went to grandma's. You took a nice hot bath. You curled up under a nice warm blanket. You turned on, you put aside your daily routine. You turned off the phone. And you just cleared your mind. And your body was at rest. Your mind was at rest. Your spirit was at rest. It was like, anybody know that kind of rest? You know what I'm talking about? When that happens, there's just this sense of peace and calm and settledness that comes over our spirit. It's a resting rest. How many of you are like, man, how different would my life be if I could just have that kind of rest 10 minutes a day? 30 minutes a day. How about an hour? An hour a day. But see, here's the good news. God wants us to enter into that kind of spiritual rest, not 10 minutes a day, not 30 minutes a day, not an hour a day, but 24/7, 7 days a week. That's not just on Sunday morning when I come to meeting. Oh, I got to get to meeting because I need some rest. That's great. We need to gather. And guess what? We come here, man, there's just a, amen. But the reality is God wants you to have that day in, day out, hour in, hour out. He wants that for your life. We say, well, how's it possible for that to even happen? You know, because you know what, Pastor? I can't sit around all day underneath a blanket. I can't sit out all day on the porch swing watching the squirrels. You know, I just can't quit my job and hang out at the beach all day. You know, because that's where I find that kind of rest, Pastor. You know, I can't do that. See, God's not talking about you and I giving up a life of activity. He's not talking about you and I, you know, checking out. He's talking about an inner rest in the midst of the activity. Inner rest in the midst of the what's going on around us. An inner rest. Look what he says in verse 4. For he has said somewhere concerning the seventh day, God rested on the seventh day from all his works. Verse 9, consequently there remains a Sabbath rest for the people. For the one who has entered his rest has himself also rested from his works, just as God did from his. Now, when God rests, is God like, you know, got his feet up and, you know, check that? No. I want you to understand that God exists in a perpetual rest. You know, God's resting today, so he didn't hear our prayers. God's resting today, he didn't know what's going on. God's resting today, you know, nothing's taking place. No, what it means is there is an inner rest in the midst of all that is going on around us. That's the desire. Because true rest is not ceasing from activity. True rest comes when it's no longer I, but Christ in me. True rest comes when he's the one who's empowering my life. True rest comes when it's Christ who's working in me. See, true rest comes when I stop trying and I simply trust Jesus. I tell you what, if the church could ever get a hold of that, we just need to stop trying and just try trusting him a little more. Amen? We're trying to get this done. We're trying to do this. We're trying to do that. We're trying to do this. See, I tell you all the time, the life he wants you and I to live is this. that we simply get on board with what he's doing and what he has for us. And when he does it, we simply get to go along for the ride. We may be busy and we may have stuff to do and we may have issues that come up, but guess what? There is a rest, a peace that comes within us. Look what it says in verse 14 here from the Amplified. Inasmuch then, if you never looked at the Amplified, Amplified's got some parentheses with some additional words in there, all right? Inasmuch then as we believers have a great high priest who has already ascended and passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession of faith and cling tenuously to our absolute trust in him. Trusting him to do what he says he's going to do. Trusting to do in my life what he wants to do in my life. It's trusting him because he's all I need. Amen. How many of you believe that? He's all I need. If I truly have Jesus, he's all I need. Amen. Think about it. Imagine a child, a young child who's being chased by a bully. We talk about bullies all the time in this society. Who's running from a bully and he's running and running and running, and all of a sudden he sees his dad. And he runs to his dad and he jumps up into his dad's arms and he grabs a hold of his dad's neck and holds on to him. All of a sudden, what happens? The bully's still standing there. But now he has absolutely no fear. Why? Because of his father. He has entered into his father's rest, even in the midst of the fact that the bully's standing 15 feet away. Our life situations, the things that are going on around us, you know, they may be chasing us, but guess what? We enter his rest when we fully trust in who he is and his ability to deal with stuff. That's the picture that we have. Let me give you a couple examples. See, I said, we understand that rest. How many of you, when you got saved, man, you confessed your sins and maybe you went to an old-fashioned, well, we don't have an old-fashioned altar, but you went to an old-fashioned altar, and I tell you what, that you entered into a rest. I still remember up here at Matthew's, Epworth Methodist Church, and, you know, I got out of that pew that Sunday and walked down to that altar and I knelt there. When I got up, man, I could have floated out of that place. There was such peace and such rest and such just, had everything in my life changed in the natural? Absolutely not. Still had the same job. I still had the same beautiful wife. I still had kids. But the reality is, it was all different. Why? Because I entered into his rest. I was no longer carrying the weight of sin. I had his rest. Or how about when the doctor said, you have cancer? Or when you were told you needed surgery, or when you came, you got the call that your loved one had been in an accident. And what'd you pray? You prayed, oh Lord, I can't control this, I can't do this, I can't, oh Lord, and all of a sudden a peace and a rest came over you. Because what happened? You took that thing and you entered his rest in the midst of that thing. And what happened? You cried out to him. Why? Because you couldn't cure cancer on your own. You couldn't operate on yourself. You couldn't drive the ambulance for your loved one. You had to trust him in the midst of that situation. See, what we need to understand is his rest is not for crisis only. Oh, let me say that again. His entering his rest is not just for crisis situations. Entering his rest is to be a 24/7 endeavor, seeking, no matter what's going on, to walk in his rest. God wants you to enter his rest, not just in crisis, but watch this. He wants you to enter his rest when you go to work. He wants you to enter his rest when you go, when you get in the car, when you are at home, when you're with the kids, when you're with the grandkids, when you're with the great-grandkids. Amen? Oh, come on. Sometimes it's kind of chaotic, right? But in the midst of the chaos, there is peace and rest because of his promise. And see, he doesn't want you and I worrying, struggling, fussing, fighting, beating ourselves up because of trying to be who he wants us to be. He says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to enter my rest as I transform you. You say, well, Brian, what's that look like? Well, it simply looks like this. He leads. Now, come on, you can help me here. He leads, I follow. You know the hardest part of the Christian life is? For the vast majority of our lives, we lead and he follows. Amen? Come on. Well, Jesus, I got a plan today, Jesus. You know, come on, how many of us are like, well, one of the most misquoted scriptures in all of the Bible. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Completely out of context. You know why? Because here's what we think that means. A lot of Christians, people are quoting that like, well, I'm going to go do this today. Jesus, you strengthen me. That's not what it says. When we are engaged in what he desires and what he has planned for us and what he wants, he says, there isn't anything that he's asking of me that I can't do because he's going to strengthen me. Woo, come on. Now that's rest. Amen? Because I don't have to fuss and fight and try and figure out how to get it done because he's the one doing it. And that's the picture he's painting for us here. He says, I want you to enter a rest. We say, well, how do I know that promise is for me? Well, verse 6 again. Therefore, since it remains for some to enter it. Wait a minute. The writer of Hebrews says, hey, some of y'all ain't in yet. Some of you haven't entered yet. It's all right. Since it remains for some to enter it, and those who previously had good news preached to them failed to enter because of the disobedience, he again sets a certain day. When's that day? Today. Hey, guess what? That's today. All right, it's today. Saying through David after a long time, just as it has been said, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. If you feel him pulling you, if you hear his voice, if you're seeking his leading, do not harden your heart, but simply enter in. Verse 8, for if Joshua had given them rest, he would have spoken to of another day after that. Consequently, there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For the one who has entered his rest has himself also rested from his works, just as God rested from his. The same perpetual state of rest that God exists in, he's made available to you and me. You say, well, Brian, that sounds way out there. It is way out there. But listen, he's done everything to make it possible for you and I to enter it. And he's saying to us, long, seek, desire to enter that rest. You say, well, Brian, how do I do that? Because isn't that like the $5 million question, how do we do that? Because how many of you are like, man, I'd like some more rest? There's two or three in the house who would like a little more rest, all right? So how do we do that? Matthew 11, a verse we've looked at before. Says, come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. We read that all the time. Again, not a salvation scripture. All right? Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is comfortable and my burden is light. You say, how do I come into this rest? Well, number one is this. You simply have to come to Jesus. You have to come to, Jesus says you got to come to me. Amen? I have to desire and want rest. I have to desire to say, you know what? This exhausted thing I'm doing over here, this struggling and fussing and carrying on thing I'm doing over here, trying to live out the life I know I'm supposed to live, I'm going to give that up, and I'm going to come and give Jesus a try on that. You say, well, I already know Jesus. I'm not talking about getting saved. I'm talking about day in, day out, living, carrying out the life he's created you for. He says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to come to me. I want you to come to me. And what's his promise? Somebody help me there. What's it say in the text? I will give you rest. I'm passed out of candy there. Here we go. I will give you rest. Now, how many of you look at that and say, well, I'm not sure he can? Come on. If we're honest, if I come to him, he will give me rest. There doesn't seem to be any conditions there, does it? No. I come to him, he will give me rest. Okay, well, that's great. You will enter his rest. But here's step number two. I got to take on his yoke. Now, there's where the real rub comes. Because what happens? Well, we've talked about it before, that when you are yoked in the natural with animals, what happens? That we take an older, stronger, more experienced oxen and put a young oxen next to them, and they're yoked together, right? Take on their yoke, and then what happens? The older oxen pulls the vast majority of the weight, and the younger oxen does what? Follows, right? He's pulling a little, he's got a little weight, but Jesus says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. That's what he's saying. He's saying, you know what? You're going to put my yoke on. But here's the problem. I can't put on his yoke until I take off the other yoke. Oh, wait a minute. Now you're meddling. I cannot be yoked with Jesus when my perspective is, I got this yoke I'm carrying, and I got to pull this weight, and I got to get it done, and I'm pulling it. Jesus doesn't say, bring me your yoke, and I'll get on your yoke. It does not say that. Well, come on, Jesus, come along. I'm really struggling here. Why don't you come alongside me and get under my yoke? That is not what the word says. But listen, that's our temptation. Our temptation to say, I'm going to keep my yoke. I'm going to keep my plans. I'm going to keep the things I'm going after. I'm going to keep those. And Jesus, you need to come along and help carry that. That's not what he said. He said, he'll help you, but guess what? You're not going to have rest. He said, here's what you need to do. Step zero. Are you ready? We probably should go back a step. You ready? Step zero, take your yoke off. Take your stuff off. Number two, come to Jesus, and then what? Let him put his yoke on you. Now, what's that yoke represent? His plan, his desires, his goals, his dreams, his passions, his direction, his destiny for your life. Come and let me put my yoke upon you. I will pull the majority of the weight. Your job is to follow alongside me, co-labor with me in carrying out what I've already taken care of. Now, here's the deal. What's the difference between me carrying the load of the yoke and me having his yoke on me? The comparison between the two is like rest. Because see, before I'm like, I'm straining and struggling and fussing, and then he puts his yoke on me, and it's like, okay, all right, we can do it. And it's like a million pounds have been lifted off of us, and we find rest in the midst of the stuff. Brenda and I have this conversation all the time. I got a lot of irons in the fire, and I'll confess, sometimes I got too many in the fire, all right? I can be honest about that. That's just been an area that God has to work on me in my life on a regular basis, all right? But here's the deal. There's certain things that I know is his yoke. And under those things, no matter how many hours, how many days, no matter how long the days are, those things, it's always easy. Now notice, I was active. I was engaged, but there was rest in the midst of those things because he's carrying those things. He's carrying them. And the reality is, he wants to carry those things in your life. You say, well, what's step three, Brian? Well, once we put on the yoke, we just have to simply trust him. Because isn't that what has to happen to the younger oxen? I don't know, Steve, when you were young, did you ever buck against stuff? Scott, when you were younger, did you buck anything in your life? Absolutely. Mom's sitting beside you, got to tell the truth, right? What happened? We're kind of like going along and we're like, I'm going to go my own way. And that's what happens in the beginning, right? That young oxen is like, hey, I kind of like to go this way. But you know what happens? That older oxen just is steady. and goes along. And what happens is that young oxen begins to trust and believe that this older oxen, the one carrying all the weight, truly knows what they're doing and will take them where they need to go to do what they need to do. That's the part. We take on his yoke, and then we begin to trust him to do what? To take us where we need to go. And in the midst of it all, we've entered his rest. It's hard for all of us, but it is a promise that God says, do not go forward without. Enter my rest. See, I want to suggest this morning that there's a lot of us in here who would like rest, but the first step for us is we got to get rid of some yokes. We got to let some yokes go in our lives that we might be yoked with Jesus. And I just felt the Lord this morning. I was in the office thinking about our message today. The Lord just really stirred my heart and said, you know what? I need my people to give up some yokes today, to let go of some yokes today. The rest of it will come. We start with, what yoke am I carrying that he didn't intend for me to carry, or that I think I should carry, or I've decided I should carry? And to lay that yoke down and say, I'm not going to carry that anymore, but instead I'm going to come and allow you, Jesus, to put your yoke upon me. In a moment we're going to pray, and then we're going to sing Good, Good Father, because he is a good father. He's so good, in fact, that he's so willing to help us lay down the yoke and help us to become yoked to him. So I just want to challenge you this morning. However Holy Spirit stirs you, maybe you got a yoke you need to get rid of and you need to leave it here today. Please come, just leave it. Maybe you need to throw one on the floor. Maybe you need to throw it off. Whatever you need to do, whatever Holy Spirit stirring you, I challenge you this morning not to leave yoked under the weight of a yoke that God never intended for you to carry. Amen. Well, Father, we just come today and we thank you for your word. We thank you that you have your blessed rest for us. And so, Lord, today we just come, and Holy Spirit, we pray that you would just stir in us. Lord, even in these last few minutes, Lord, as you've been stirring our hearts and pointing out yokes and Lord, speaking into our hearts, today if we hear your voice, do not harden our hearts. Lord, enable us not to harden our hearts, but to respond to your voice, respond to the Spirit, respond to what you would have for our lives. And Lord, as we respond, Lord, we know that rest will come as we enter in to the blessed rest that you've given for us. We thank you now, Father, in your mighty name.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm in love by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call.
You are a good, good Father. And Lord, as we go forth from here, Holy Spirit, may you simply put a passion, a desire, a drive in our hearts for the rest that you desire, the rest that you give. And Lord, we'll be grateful and we'll give you all the praise. And all God's people said, amen.